a little bit of my background so you can see where I'm coming from. I first learned to program in Fortran, as many of us older folks did, in college in 1970. I find it hard to believe it was 52 years ago that I was learning how to program Fortran. So that's why the subtitle of this book, Software Development Pearls, is Lessons from 50 Years of Software Experience. Since then, since my Fortran days, I've had a lot of experience with software development in many forms. And in fact, 1/3 of my PhD thesis in organic chemistry was code. And that certainly wasn't something very common back then. I moved from chemistry into full-time software development nearly 40 years ago. Since then, I've also worked as a software manager and a software quality and process improvement leader. In 1997, I started my software consulting and training company, Process Impact, through which I've provided services and products to about 150 companies and government agencies of all types. In fact, I actually have a special Winnipeg winter rate that I had to invent when I did some work for the Canadian Wheat Board up in Winnipeg at a very cold time of the year. So through my personal experience and by observing and hearing from my consulting clients and students who have taken hundreds of classes, I accumulated a lot of lessons and insights about many aspects of software development. And I wrote this book to share 60 of those lessons. You know, experience is a great teacher, but it's also an expensive and painful way to learn. And I learned a long time ago that you just don't have time to make every mistake that every software developer before you has already made. You can avoid a lot of the pain by learning from those who have gone before. So my goal with this book is to help everyone improve their software effectiveness quickly by reducing some of those unpleasant learning curves. So today I'm going to tell you about the structure and contents of the book. 59 of the lessons are grouped into 6 critical areas of software development. I don't cover some other important areas such as coding and testing and configuration management. There are plenty of other good books on those topics. So the book contains 16 lessons about requirements, which is an area I've been interested in for a long time, 6 lessons about design, 12 on project management, 8 lessons about culture and teamwork, which is a pretty important topic, and 8 lessons on quality, and then 9 lessons about software process improvement. I'm not going to try to cover all of the lessons in this brief presentation, but I'll show you several lessons in each of these 6 areas, and I'll drill down into 1 lesson in each category in more detail. So that adds up to 59. Finally, lesson number 60 is about what do you do next with all of this knowledge? And so the book closes with a short chapter on how to begin your journey toward more effective software development by applying some selected guidance from the book to the project challenges that all of us face every day. Each of the 6 subdomain topic chapters in the book is structured in the same way. First, I provide a brief introductory tutorial on the topic to give some background for understanding the lessons. And I'm guessing that most of you would be pretty familiar with that kind of brief foundation. Then comes a series of first steps to get you started thinking about issues that you and your team face in that particular subdomain. After that's a series of essays, one on each of these lessons. And the lessons include many true experience examples that illustrate the lesson, both from my personal experience, and I also collected a lot of examples, a lot of stories of real experiences people have had on projects from many different people. Along with that, I've shared some key points and descriptions of numerous practices that you can apply in your projects to put each of the lessons into action. Then each chapter concludes with some next steps to get you started. So let me talk a little bit more about the first steps and the next steps. First steps start by maybe giving you some questions to think about to sort of set your mind in a frame that says, all right, let's think about where we are now in that area and where our points of pain are and what we're good at. So start by thinking about what you're good at in, say, requirements or project management. But then it's also important to identify the problems we experience. And don't just talk about the problems, think about their impacts. What impact does that have on each of your projects? And more importantly, what are the root causes? You can't treat symptoms, you have to treat root causes. And I think we don't spend enough time thinking about root causes before we dive into some solution that we hope will solve a particular problem. Then at the end of each chapter, we've got a series of next steps, and they encourage you to think about the relevant lessons that you encountered in that chapter, along with your own lessons. I mean, you're all experienced people. You've done a lot of stuff. You work with other smart, experienced people. And so think about what you can learn from each other. We all have our own lessons collection. And then try to identify practices that you think might address the problem areas that you identified during the first steps. It's also useful when you think of a practice that seems like it might be helpful to identify any barriers you might encounter if you decide you're going to try to implement that practice. Identifying those barriers is a good way to start breaking them down. Whoops, my mouse is being very touchy here. And finally, we might want to think about some templates or procedures or guidance documents or checklists or other work aids that you could put into place in your organization that would make it easier for the people around you to also learn from each other and to try to get the best of everybody's experience, the best of everybody's wisdom and insight applied so that we can all do a better job by looking over each other's shoulders. So let's start with requirements. I've been interested in how improving how projects handle their requirements for a long time. And I've written several books on that topic. And in fact, I am right now finishing up another book. The current working title, which may change once the marketing people get a hold of it, is Requirements Distilled, Core Practices for Real World Success. And in this new book, which I'm co-authoring with a woman named Candace Hokanson, who works at Argonne Digital. Argonne Digital used to be called C-Level. And if any of you are familiar with my book on software requirements, my co-author Joy Beatty is a vice president at Argonne Digital. So Candace works with her. And we have distilled down this great big monster book I wrote about 10 years ago with Joy down to 20 topics that I think represent the most important practices that any project should apply around requirements. So that book should be out around April. We're finishing that up right now. Now, the reason why I'm so interested in requirements is because they're the foundation for all of the project work that follows. And I have 16 lessons on requirements in software development pearls. Here are four of them that I always keep in mind. The very first lesson says, if you don't get the requirements right, it doesn't matter how well you execute the rest of the project. You will probably fail. Now, by this, I don't mean that you need to get all of the requirements right at the very beginning before you start writing code. We all know that doesn't work very well in most situations. Ultimately, though, a successful project requires that you understand the customer's problems and the capabilities and characteristics that a suitable solution must have. And that's what requirements is all about. Someone asked me a little while ago, what's the most important lesson that you've learned in your career about software? And this is it. A usage-centric approach to requirements will meet customer needs better than a feature or product-centric approach. I found that it works much better to focus requirements discussions not on the product and its features, but rather on the users and what they need to do with the product or the solution that you build. From that usage-centric understanding, you notice I didn't say user-centric, I said usage-centric. Important distinction. So from that understanding, we can deduce the necessary product functionality that will let people do the things they need to do. On the other hand, if you take a feature-centric approach and focus on the product and it's little bits of functionality, you can end up with a pile of functionality fragments that might not let users get their jobs done. And you can also end up implementing functionality that's rarely or never used. I don't know if any of you have had that experience on a project, but most people have. And you know, you work just as hard building the functionality that no one uses as you did building the stuff they do use. So let's not do as much of that as maybe we have in the past. Another lesson here is that agile requirements aren't different from other requirements. Sometimes people talk about agile requirements as though they are, somehow distinct, but I don't think they are. I think developers need the same information to write the necessary code correctly, regardless of the development model being used, how you choose to represent the knowledge or what you call it. I don't think there's such a thing as agile requirements. I think there are requirements for agile projects, but you need the same information and the user doesn't care how you built the software. So let's not try to pretend that those are different. This is, I think, a really important lesson. The cost of recording knowledge is small compared to the cost of acquiring knowledge. Some people don't want to take the time to write down information, but I think that's a mistake. Writing requirements isn't the hard part. The hard part is figuring out what the requirements are. The same is true of project plans. Identifying all the many tasks, dependencies, risks, and so forth, that's the hard part. And maybe you feel like, well, we don't have to write a plan. Okay, but writing down that information is really just transcription. Maybe some of you have had the experience where you had to figure out what a system does through reverse engineering, so you can figure out how to modify it or add some new capability. Well, if you do that, you might want to write down what you learned so that you or someone else doesn't have to repeat the reverse engineering in the future to make the next change in that part of the system. So I don't have a lot of patience with people who say, well, we don't have time to write this down. What they're really saying is, but we have plenty of time to rediscover it later on if we ever need to. I think that's a poor trade-off. So let's take a closer look at another lesson, which is that requirements elicitation must bring the voice of the customer close to the ear of the developer. Unless you're building software for yourself, you'll always have a gulf between customers with needs and developers who build solutions. So every project team needs to establish effective communication pathways between those two communities. Your options for how to do that depend on things like how many participants are involved, who and where they are, how well those communities understand each other and the vocabulary, and the software team's skill set. So here are five common communication pathways that projects can use to bring the VOC, voice of the customer, close to the EOD, ear of the developer. You know, it's funny, the VOC phrase was very popular, I don't know, 20, 25 years ago, something like that. And you don't hear that much anymore. And yet I think that's exactly what we need to hear. So I'm kind of sorry that term seems to have disappeared. I worked on a project once when I was the only developer working with a single customer. And we could talk directly. That's the ideal situation. But having all your customers talk with all your developers leads to chaos on a sizable project. Generally, you need some intermediaries to broker and facilitate the conversations. And that's where BAs kind of come in. A model that my teams found to work very well was to identify distinct classes of users and then identify specific individuals that we called product champions to serve as representatives for each of those user classes. You know, sometimes people think of you know, having these user representatives as a new idea. We were doing this on our projects when I worked at Kodak in 1985. That's when we started doing the product champion approach, and it just really made a heck of a difference. In fact, one of the things that's fun about being a trainer or a consultant is you get to come into contact with a whole lot of people doing a whole lot of different things. And many years ago, I taught a class on requirements once, a public session, and there was a person from one class or from one company who was in the class, and they liked this product champion idea. Well, about a year later, I taught another public class and somebody else from that same company was there. And they said that after the person went to the first class, they went back to work and they ended up setting up product champions for all of their projects. And they felt like they were getting much better results as an effect. So it's always nice to hear that the crackpot schemes you come up with and find work for you actually work for other people too. So the product champions that we came up with would work with our business analysts to develop requirements. And it also helped with things like making decisions on change requests. They might help with writing test cases. Some of them would write user documentation. I mean, we had some product champions that just added a huge amount of value to our projects. If you're working in a commercial software development company, you might have marketing people who work with a product manager to define the market requirements and the solution's characteristics. Most agile projects have a product owner who establishes the product's vision and goal. The PO creates and communicates the contents of the product backlog. So the PO serves pretty much both as the customer rep and the BA in that situation, but some agile teams do also include a business analyst who works with the product owner to facilitate that critical communication between customers and developers. So any of these communication models and probably others can work, but when you're planning a project, take some time to determine the best mechanisms for having suitable representatives communicate requirements information efficiently and accurately to the development team. Well, if the domain of requirements is about defining problems and the characteristics that solutions must have, design is about crafting those solutions. Software design encompasses four major aspects: architectural design, detailed design, database design, and user experience design. And all of these design aspects are subject to numerous constraints that restrict the options that are available to the designer. So a good design has to efficiently accommodate enhancement and modification, both during the initial development process and following release. So here are four of my lessons about software design. I don't know about you, but I've found that I just can't get the design right on the first try, so I have to plan to iterate as I explore different design alternatives. And incidentally, the same is true about requirements. We need to iterate. You know, that's frustrating for people. Sometimes they'll think, well, haven't we already had this conversation? Why are we revisiting this topic? Well, we need to learn more about it, or I've learned something that makes me question our previous discussion or something. So it's just an intrinsic component and aspect of what we do. So prototypes are one effective iteration technique. But if you're thinking about doing prototypes or saying, well, why don't we just build the first release and we'll get some feedback and see what people think, I've also learned that it's cheaper to iterate at higher levels of abstraction than on working code. Let me show you what I mean. Suppose we could draw a curve like this that shows the cost of iteration, that is the cost of trying something again, as a function of the abstraction level you're working at. And by abstraction, I'm talking about code being at a very low level of abstraction and concepts being at a high level. So this diagram shows that iterating, and incidentally, this is qualitative, there's no scales here, but iterating at the higher abstraction levels, like on a product concept, on analysis models and requirements, or even on design models, that takes less effort and it costs less than if you repeatedly modify the project artifacts at a lower level of abstraction, such as the detailed designs themselves and the code. So I'm a big fan of both analysis and design modeling. This area right around here is kind of the sweet spot. Now, one thing I want to suggest is if you get into modeling, and I'll tell you frankly, when I learned about analysis and design modeling relatively early in my career, it totally changed how I approached software development. I mean, it was a completely new concept to me to draw pictures of different kinds before you started writing code. And I found that to be enormously powerful, and I just love the modeling approach. But use a standard modeling notation. That's my strong advice. Please do not invent your own notation. There are lots of modeling languages out there, lots of kinds of pictures that we can draw. And it is highly unlikely, in my view, that you'll need to represent some information in a way that requires you to invent some new diagram. And the reason why this is so important is because modeling languages and different diagrams are a communication mechanism. They're a language. And the whole point of languages is to communicate. And if you're using notations that the person reading your picture isn't familiar with, then you're not going to communicate effectively. I remember one time as a consultant, I was reviewing some models that one of my clients had asked me to take a look at. And there was one particular diagram, I think it was a context diagram, in fact, very basic thing that someone had drawn. And I understand context diagrams and I understood the notations being used, but the person who drew it had introduced two new different types of arrows, you know, different, I don't know, dashed or dotted or something that meant something to that person, but there was no legend or anything. And I honestly had no idea what those meant. So the fact that this person had invented their own notation was completely lost on me and we did not communicate well. So don't invent your own. But by creating models, these diagrams that represent various aspects of a proposed design, you can easily modify those as you get more information or new ideas that help you improve your initial design. Iteration is a key success factor. I'm sure that you have used products that were harder than necessary to use and led to unnecessary user errors. So let's design products that are both easy to use correctly and hard for people to use incorrectly. In addition, I've learned that it's impossible to optimize all of the desirable quality attributes that a product could have. Cannot optimize those all simultaneously. Products of all kinds have many quality characteristics that describe not what the product does, but rather how well it does the things that it does. These are a kind of non-functional requirements, and they're a big contributor to customer satisfaction. But you can't get the best of all possible worlds. There are trade-offs. So if you're a designer, you need to know which of these many attributes are most important to business success and focus on those. Sometimes increasing one attribute decreases another, or vice versa. I'll give you an example. You know, we're very concerned about computer security these days. And so what a lot of systems have done is implemented multi-factor authentication. Okay, that's fine. I don't know about you, but I get really, really tired of getting this endless stream of text messages with codes to type in. Or it's even dumber if I want to watch certain streaming services on my TV and I have to use my phone to put in a code at a website to be able to make my TV work. So I understand those are all optimizing or enhancing security, but you're paying a usability price in each of those cases. So there are trade-offs. That's why exploring quality attributes during requirements discussions and aligning those with the project's business objectives helps the designers make appropriate trade-off choices. But you can't get the best of all of them at once. So let's look more carefully at another design lesson, which is that an ounce of design is worth a pound of recoding. Rework, such as fixing designs that have problems, takes away time there that you'd rather be spending building new software. And we're going to come back to that theme. That's one of my big bugaboos is rework. Designs that are executed in haste can generate technical debt, shortcomings that someone must resolve in the future to try to maintain the product's proper functioning and expandability. If you think about designs more carefully the first time, you can reduce technical debt, which otherwise needs to be repaid eventually. Either that or your customers are going to pay the price for the technical debt and the problems. So rework to reduce technical debt often takes the form of refactoring. Refactoring is the process of restructuring existing code to improve its design, but without changing its functioning. You might decide to restructure some code to simplify it or make it more maintainable or extensible to improve its efficiency. You might want to remove duplicated and unneeded portions or make other improvements. Those are all good things. And refactoring is a way to pay off technical debt. Architectural restructuring to accommodate new functionality or to improve key quality attributes like maybe availability, that's particularly disruptive and time-consuming. So I think you should spend a little more time on design than we might otherwise. There's another word for design, it's called thinking. I'm a big fan of thinking. I remember when I worked at Kodak in the photographic research labs, you might remember Kodak, it was a photographic company once upon a time before it like disappeared. And I remember I had a friend, he had a job called a film builder. He was one of these guys that designed, you know, the structure of some new kind of film. And once in a while, I'd bump into him in his office and he'd just be sitting in his chair, kind of staring off into space, looking up into the corner of the ceiling. And you think, well, what's he doing? He's not doing any work. Well, he was thinking. And, you know, it turns out he spent more time on thinking and a lot less time than average on building films because he did a better job on his first tries. That resonated with me. But as with most things in life, you need a thoughtful balance. Time that you spend considering a design, or what my friend Ken Pugh whimsically calls pre-factoring, is more than repaid by time you don't spend fixing problems later, at least up to a point. You can certainly waste time trying to perfect a design in the face of uncertainties, so you need to scale your design efforts to the nature of the problem. But nonetheless, creating better designs in the first place helps you avoid excessive redesign and recoding. I try to avoid doing anything that involves an RE in front of it, refactoring, recoding, you know, rework of any type. Let's try not to do any more of that than we have to. There's always some, but it doesn't have to be as much. Let's move on to project management. And in my opinion, project management is not a discrete discipline. Instead, project management involves managing many activities that in the aggregate contribute to project success. So project management activities include managing people, requirements, expectations, tasks, commitments, risks, communications. We'll probably have some changes to deal with. We might have to juggle resources. There are usually dependencies, and sometimes you have contracts and suppliers to deal with. So these activities could be performed by a single individual or by a group or a hierarchy of managers on a large project, or they could be done collaboratively by partitioning these activities among multiple team members. But collectively, they amount to what we call project management. And here are four of my 12 lessons about project management. I think the best answer to a request for an estimate, we all have to produce estimates, but the best answer to a request for an estimate is, let me get back to you on that. Don't give people an estimate off the top of your head. These off-the-cuff estimates that are prepared with too little information and too little analysis are often too low, and yet they sound a lot like a commitment to the person who hears it. This is kind of an important one. Icebergs are always larger than they first appear, and projects are almost always bigger at the end than you think they're going to be when you start. So a very good idea is, no matter what life cycle you're following, a very good idea is to incorporate contingency buffers to try to accommodate a certain amount of growth without disrupting plans and commitments and all the other things going on. Plus, there are always surprises that happen. And so I think it's good to have a certain amount of slack built into your schedules, even if it's just, you know, increment to increment, build in some slack time to account for the unexpected. Let me give you an example of where I saw this, or the opposite, in action. So one time I was working with a client that was building a really big product. This was like a 5-year project with dozens of people working on it. And I was talking to a senior manager on that project once, and I told him about some data I'd seen in the software literature that said that on typical large, long-term software projects, the requirements tend to grow by 1 to 3% per month. So I said, do you think it's possible that your project could get larger by about 2% per month? And he said, yeah, that's certainly possible. And so I said, okay, so that means that on a 5-year project, 2% per month, 60 months, your project could be more than twice as big as you think it is today. Is that possible? And he said, yeah, I think so. So I asked him the important question. I said, have you built any contingency buffers into your plans to try to accommodate some of that growth? And his predictable answer was, everybody all together now? No. Well, one of the bad things about being a consultant is you usually don't find out what happens at the end of a project because you go away and do something else. But I'm guessing that project took more than 5 years. So I always like to build in contingency plans, contingency buffers to accommodate time. In fact, just let me back up one step here. If you do not have contingency buffers built in, okay, why is that not going up? Let's try that. If you do not build in contingency buffers, then you're assuming all of your estimates are correct. You're assuming that no new requirements will come along. You're assuming that nothing will turn out to be bigger than you thought it was. You're assuming that all the people you have working today will still be working there when you get later on in the project, and there won't be any turnover, nobody will get sick, nobody will have to work from home less efficiently than they might have otherwise. None of those things will happen. Are those good assumptions? No, they're horrible assumptions. So let's deal with reality. I often like to point out that, you know, I'm not that crazy about reality sometimes, but it's all I got, so I have to work with it. Now, there's an old joke that software projects are always 90% done. There's kind of a related joke that says the first half of a software project consumes the first 90% of the resources, and the second half of the project consumes the other 90% of the resources. So these are jokes, but they're way too close to reality. So they're kind of sardonic jokes. Now, one reason why projects might seem like they're 90% done for a long time is that if you try to track the percent completion of individual tasks, you can think you're farther along than you really are. You keep bumping into more work that has to be done that you either hadn't thought of or thought somebody else was doing or thought was going to go quicker than it does and so forth. So I prefer to do binary status tracking of small tasks rather than trying to track what percentage of a big thing you've got done, a milestone. Let's track which of the small tasks, inch pebbles, get it, are done. So they're either done or they're not done. You get no partial credit. I think that's an important way to monitor progress. Take some discipline to get yourself in the habit of doing that, but I think it's a good idea. Now, you might have heard of the iron triangle or the triple constraint of project management, but I think that's an oversimplification. In fact, I know it's wrong because I've seen too many different representations of the iron triangle with different labels on the vertices, and also that different assumptions about quality. Is quality a given? Is quality adjustable? Whatever. So I think in terms of five dimensions: scope, schedule, staff, budget, and quality. And you need to be able to adjust one or more of those dimensions to be able to cope with changing situations. An over-constrained project will almost certainly fail. You know, an added feature, a team member who departs, a risk that becomes a problem, an estimate that's too low, all of those will trash your schedule and your commitments because the over-constrained project has no flexibility to respond to those events. So I was teaching a class once at a government agency, and one of the students said, well, all right, here's our project. We've got a fixed feature set that has to be delivered. There can't be any defects. It has to be delivered on schedule. We can't get more people and the budget's frozen. What should we do? And my answer is you will almost certainly fail because you have no flexibility to respond to any of these changes that happen all the time to projects. Again, I don't know how it came out, but hopefully she got the message. So I heard a conversation at work one day. The manager said, Jamie, you're doing the usability assessments on our project right now. We have some other projects that are interested in that service. About how much time do you spend on those? Jamie said, about 8 hours a week. So the manager said, oh, okay, so you could work with five projects at a time then. Now, do you see any flaws in that thinking? You know, five projects times 8 hours per project per week is 40, the nominal hours in a work week. So that discussion seems reasonable on the surface, but the manager had not considered the many factors that reduce the time that individuals have available for project work each day. And that's what I call project friction. I'm talking about project friction that slows things down, not interpersonal friction. That's a whole nother thing. It's very real, but we're not going to get into that here. And the problem is that people do not actually multitask. They task switch. And task switching excessively, like moving across five projects, doing things during the course of a week, that clobbers your productivity because it takes time to gather together all the materials that you need to work on a different activity and reload your brain with the pertinent information. You need to change your mental context to focus on the new problem and try to remember where you were the last time you worked on it. Now, we've all had this experience. You're deeply immersed in some work. You're focused on the activity. You're free from distractions. And you enter a highly productive mental state called flow. And then your phone rings, or you get a text, or somebody stops by your office with a question, or you see some email come in, or you just get bored or distracted or something. And these interruptions, like those that come from frequent task switching, kill your flow. And it takes a while to get back to that productive state. Some people are better than that than others. I don't know if I just have a short attention span or what, but I'm pretty good at switching from one task to another. But I've worked with people who, you know, if they got interruptions, they just basically got nothing done because it took too long to get back into that state of flow where you're really productive. And some studies have shown that it can take as long as 15 minutes to recover from interruption and say, okay, now where was I? Just kind of get everything lined up in your head so you're back to working the way you were. So the important message here is that your hours at work does not equal your hours devoted to project work. And various studies, including my own experience, have suggested that software people average only about 5 hours of uninterrupted attentive time for project tasks per day. I worked in a group for several years where we kept track of our work effort metrics. We wanted to know where we spent our time on our projects. So every one of us, every day for several years, just made a note of, okay, what kind of life cycle activity, you know, requirements, design, coding, testing, whatever. What were you doing on which project? And how many hours did you spend on it? And the most we ever got was about 32 hours per week on an average. And that was after we started with lower and focused on improving it. So 5 hours a day is probably about right for average productivity. Now, there are some other sources of project friction, of course, that reduce your productivity, like having to enhance or fix defects in some existing system or in previously completed work. Collaborating and communicating across distances, which all of us are doing not only right this minute, but pretty much every day, that slows things down, as can cultural differences among team members who have different communication and work styles. So you really need to consider all of these factors when you're preparing estimates and making commitments. You cannot simply assume that each team member is available for 40 hours per week of project work. Again, that's just the reality. The fourth topic here is culture and teamwork. Every organization, every company, department, and team has its own culture. And in brief, the culture describes how do we do things around here? A healthy software culture is characterized by a set of common values and technical practices that drive the behaviors and decisions of people in the organization. In fact, my very first book came out in 1996, was called Creating a Software Engineering Culture. And I think a healthy software engineering culture includes commitments at the individual level, the project team and organizational levels to build high quality products through the sensible application of appropriate processes and practices. And if all goes well, the team members have a good time along the way too. So here are a handful of lessons that I've learned about culture and teamwork. One important lesson is that knowledge is not zero sum. Unlike other commodities, if I give you some of my knowledge, I still have it myself. And a healthy organization fosters a culture of free knowledge exchange and continuous learning. I don't have much patience with people who hoard their knowledge rather than sharing it with their colleagues. If you're lucky, you've never met someone like this, but I have. And let me tell you about Ron. I worked with Ron once and he had more experience than I did in some areas. So I'd go ask Ron a question and I could almost hear the wheels grinding in his brain as I asked him his question. He'd be thinking, gee, if I give Carl the whole answer to his question, he'll be as smart as me in that respect. And I don't want that because I'll lose my edge. So I'll give Carl half the answer and see if he goes away. So I'd go away with half the answer and I'd come back for more later and I'd get half of what was left. So I would asymptotically approach getting an answer. I found that very annoying. We were working for the same company. We're on the same side. We can all flourish. So I'm a big believer in both looking over other people's shoulders and sharing what I know with other people. Of course, as a consultant, sometimes they have to pay for it, but we can work that out. Now, several of my consulting clients have told me something interesting. They said, I'm being asked to do more with less. Okay. They want to get more productivity, but they can't get more people or anything else. And so I would ask them, I said, well, what's being done to enable you to get more done with less? And the answer was always, nothing. Well, that's silly. If you're not given the means to make that happen, what do? You can't just go out and replace your whole team with 90th percentile people. And in fact, I have to laugh every time I read an article about, you know, some company that's got all these 90th percentile developers, and that's why they're doing so fabulous. It turns out that 50% of all software developers are below average in capability. Specifically, it's below median, but close enough. And all those people work somewhere. So we can't all work with absolutely top tier people. So if you want to make yourself and your team more productive, that's going to require a combination of better tools, better training, better processes and practices. You don't just decree it and then wonder why it didn't happen. People talk a lot about their rights, not only in software projects, but in daily life and politics and everything else. But it turns out that the flip side of every right is a responsibility. Groups and individuals who collaborate have rights they can expect from each other, but they also have responsibilities to each other. It's good to agree on those rights and responsibilities right up front to facilitate effective and hopefully conflict-free collaboration. I think if you're working with somebody else, you have the absolute right, in fact, the responsibility, to say to them, here's what I need from you. If we are collectively going to be successful, what do you need from me? And I think we rarely say that. Well, if you want to change how an organization functions, you should not underestimate the challenge of changing the culture as it moves towards new ways of working. You cannot change an organization's culture by issuing a decree or policy or adopting some new lifestyle method or methodology. You can't give them a bunch of new technical procedures and say, we're going to do this now, forget everything else you know. That does not change the culture. Moving to new ways of working often requires as much cultural change as technical change, but it's harder and slower to make the cultural changes. So here's another aspect about culture and teamwork. My lesson says, no matter how much pressure others exert, you should never make a commitment that you know you can't fulfill. Let me give you an example. Once upon a time, I was leading process improvement activities in a large software division of about 450 software and systems engineers. And we were trying to follow a particular process improvement model that was popular at the time, and several other organizations in our company had done this. And I had a meeting with the division director, Martin. Martin was three levels above me on the organization chart. He wanted to know how we were coming, and he was pressuring me to commit my process improvement group to achieving a specific goal in what we considered to be an impossible time frame. Now, we'd carefully thought about this. We'd talked to people in other organizations. We had read the literature where there was a lot of publication about this, and there was simply no way that what he was asking for could be achieved. And finally, in this conversation, I told him, Martin, I can't commit to that. It's kind of funny. My boss was with us there as well. And so he went back and told everybody, Carl said he wasn't going to commit. Martin seemed kind of surprised, the senior manager. I don't think he'd ever had anybody tell him that before. He wasn't sure what to say, but I was not going to make a commitment that I knew my team and I could not fulfill. Nobody wins with that. So a commitment is a promise that someone makes to perform an action or deliver some body of work in a certain quality state at a specific time. And commitments accumulate in dependency chains. Each commitment recipient depends on those who made the commitments to deliver. Let me show you an example. Suppose you've got a project manager who makes some commitments to the project sponsor about what they're going to deliver and when, and the project sponsor makes, let's say, some resource commitments to the project manager. Similarly, the project sponsor may have exchanged commitments with some leading customer. The project manager might be having to work with some suppliers who make commitments to each other. Certainly, the project manager is going to expect some commitments from their team members about what they're going to deliver and when, and make commitments back to them about how they're going to help make that happen. And one team member makes commitments to others. Now, if everyone negotiates achievable commitments in good faith, they can rely on one another. Otherwise, this whole chain is a house of cards, and any unfulfilled lower level commitments will undermine the entire chain. Now, sometimes we make commitments in good faith, but then you discover that you cannot fulfill a commitment for whatever reason. Now, if this happens to you, please, please, please tell the people who are affected as soon as possible so they can adjust their plans accordingly. That is just being courteous. And I'm particularly sensitive to this. So let me tell you a little bit about how writing a book works. So I've written 14 books now. I've had the same thing happen on every single book over a span of, 27 years or something now. And what happens is I invite a number of people, let's say 15 to 20 people, to serve as peer reviewers. Sometimes they're called beta readers, especially for non-technical books. And these are people who just provide a huge amount of value in terms of making what I write much better before it goes out to the world. Sometimes they save me from myself. And so I really rely on their input. And the same thing happens every single time. It just baffles me. There will be some people, maybe two or three, who give me just terrific feedback, just wonderful input I couldn't live without, and I'm really grateful to them. There's a bunch of people who give me, different degrees of helpful or less helpful input, okay. And then there are several people who I never hear from again, sometimes ever in my whole life. It's like they were abducted by space aliens or took a vow of silence immediately after agreeing to be reviewers. They don't tell me they're not going to do it. They just simply don't ever give me any feedback and never explain it. And frankly, I don't appreciate that. I mean, I line these people up, and all you have to do, I understand things change. If you can't do something you said you were going to do, just tell people so they know how to respond and can adjust. That seems simple to me. Now, my own practice is to undercommit and overdeliver. Maybe that makes me look overly cautious at times, but it also makes me reliable, and I'm okay with that trade-off. Let's move on to quality. People have tried to define the word quality for ages, but it's elusive. I've seen many attempts at it, but I'm aware of no all-inclusive yet succinct definition of quality that applies to software. So we can draw two conclusions from all those many definitions. First, quality has multiple aspects. And second, quality is situational. So each team needs to explore what quality means to its customers, how to assess it, and how to achieve it, and then communicate that knowledge clearly to all project participants. So here are some lessons I've learned about software quality. You've probably heard the expression, well, you can pay me now or you can pay me later. Well, when it comes to software quality, you can pay now or you can pay more, sometimes much more, later. The cost of correcting a defect depends on when it was introduced into the product and when someone found and then fixed it. Fixing it early costs less than fixing it late. I don't care what life cycle you're following, that is always true. Later on, it's harder to find the underlying defect that caused a problem, and more software components have to be modified: requirements, designs, code, tests, and so on. So let's try to fix it early rather than late. That is, let's push quality to the left or to the front of the development cycle. And there are several ways to do that. Here's another thing that's always kind of baffled me. You'd think that if a system were so vital and urgent that management placed great pressure on the IT staff to rush it out, it would be worth building it properly. And yet it appears organizations never have time to build software right, but they always seem to find the people, the money, the time to fix it later. So people cut quality corners in their haste, which doesn't make the product any better. It just means that they have to fix it later. And I learned about this long, long, long time ago. My high school chemistry lab had a sign on the wall that asked, if you don't have time to do it right, when will you have time to do it over? I totally internalized that message. So I always try hard to do the job right the first time. I like to think that everyone tries hard to do the job right the first time. But the fact is, sometimes we cut quality corners and you pay a price for that eventually. And as number one tells us, or rule or lesson 43 here, it's going to cost you more to fix it later. I've always thought it was better to ask one of my professional colleagues to help me find errors in my work than to wait for the customer to report a problem. And have you ever noticed that when the customer reports a problem, they're almost never in a good mood? So I would really rather not have to deal with those. So I'm a big fan of technical peer reviews. In fact, I'm such a big fan that two things. One, I wrote a book on this some time ago called Peer Reviews in Software, a Practical Guide, because I think it's really important. And second, I would never consider working in an organization if peer reviews were not an intrinsic part of the culture and the attitude that it's good to get help from your friends. So another lesson here is that today has got to get it out right away. Development project is tomorrow's maintenance nightmare. In the rush to get some working software into the customer's hands, people sometimes skimp on design and sound software engineering practices. So you accumulate technical debt in that way that makes it harder and harder to change a product to add new capabilities. That accrued technical debt must be repaid later on in the production and maintenance part of the product's lifecycle. Conscious technical debt, where you make a choice to say, okay, we can live with that and we'll deal with it thusly, that's one thing. But unconscious technical debt that arises from rushed development, that's a bigger problem, I think. So let's look a little bit more at my premise that high quality naturally leads to higher productivity. Organizations and individuals who develop software would all love to be more productive, but quality problems pose one of the greatest barriers to high productivity. So I think when you are aiming for a goal or trying to solve a problem, it's always good to understand, why are you not already achieving that goal? So if you want higher productivity, ask yourself, why is your productivity not already as high as you would like? Do we ask that question or do we just say, oh, I got to do something different to give me higher productivity? Well, let's ask the question first, and then we can choose the right ways to try to improve our productivity. And in many cases, rework is a big contributing factor. Teams plan to get a certain amount of work done in a specified time, but then they have to fix problems found in completed work, maybe divert some effort to repair a system that's in production. That rework saps time and it lowers morale. So one way to boost productivity is to create high quality software from the outset so that teams can spend less time on rework, both during development and following deployment. I hate rework. I hate doing over something that I've already completed. Now, some rework is unavoidable. It's the nature of what we do. Okay, that's fine. But I think most organizations don't measure how much of their time they do spend on rework that's potentially avoidable, doing things over. I'd be interested to know if any of your organizations actually measure that or even think about it. And those that do find that it might be up to 40 or 50% of your total software effort is spent doing things over, fixing stuff. Imagine if you could cut that in half, how much your productivity would go up to build new useful stuff. So it's worth asking yourself, what is your organization's rework level? Use that as a point to begin by thinking, am I okay with that? Maybe you are, maybe it's just reasonable, but maybe you say, let's do something about that. So let's think about the cost of quality. There are two major classes of software rework, fixing defects and paying off technical debt. As I mentioned earlier, defect correction costs grow over time. So finding and fixing defects early, or even better, preventing defects, is cheaper than waiting for the customer to report a problem. The total cost of quality consists of the time and money you spend on four activities: preventing defects, detecting them through various kinds of quality appraisal activities like testing and reviews, fixing defects prior to release, which is called internal failure, and external failure, or fixing them after release. So you should invest in defect prevention by having better processes and early detection, like through peer reviews, static code analysis, and early test thinking. And that approach lets you spend less time on late stage rework, which leaves more time for new development work, and that's how you increase your productivity. There are other ways, of course, too, with tools and whatnot, but this is one of them. All right, the final category I want to talk about, and that's covered in the book, is process improvement. I've never known anyone who could truthfully say, I am building software today as well as software could ever be built. And unless you can legitimately make that claim, you should always look for better ways to conduct your software projects. And that's what software process improvement, or SPI, is all about. The objective of SPI is to reduce the cost of developing and maintaining software. It's not to generate a shelf full of processes and procedures. It's not to comply with the dictates of the process improvement or project management framework that's currently the most fashionable. SPI is a means to an end, and the end is superior business results, however you define that. So here are some lessons I've learned from leading process improvement efforts over about the last 30 years. Watch out for management by business week. Sometimes people will leap to adopt the latest new development approach, hoping it will magically solve all their problems. But before you settle on any new approach, go back to that important question and ask yourself, what's preventing us from achieving those better results today? So do some root cause analysis. I'm a big fan of root cause analysis. To understand the problem before you choose a solution that may or may not help. That's true for process improvement, and it's true for projects for that matter. Make sure you understand the problem correctly. Now, when people are asked to do something different or extra, like maybe participate in a review of someone else's work on their team, their instinctive reaction is to wonder, well, what's in it for me? But that's the wrong question. A better question is, what's in it for us? So effective change initiatives have to consider the team's collective results, not just the impact on each individual's productivity, effectiveness, or comfort level. Sometimes, you know, there's nothing in it for you personally, and you're reluctant to do that new thing. But if you can be persuaded that if you do this, then collectively downstream, we might come out well ahead, maybe that's a little more motivating. I also think the best motivation for changing how people work is pain. I don't mean artificial externally induced pain, like managers or customers who demand the impossible. but rather the very real pain we experience from our current ways of working. But sometimes the pain's not apparent to everyone involved. Therefore, they might not be motivated to make useful changes. Like suppose you've got a development team and then you've got, you know, a maintenance team that makes modifications and bug fixes and enhancements after a system's in production. Well, maybe the development team is working in certain ways that cause headaches and more problems and cost and effort for the maintenance team. Unless there's a feedback loop from the maintenance team back to the development team that says, hey, look, we need to do something about this. This is not ideal. Unless there's a way to make the pain go back to the higher levels or the earlier levels, nobody knows about it. If the pain's not apparent to everybody, how can they even care about doing something? So change leaders need to explain why doing something different can reduce the collective pain. Change leaders also need to keep the effort visible, treating the process like a project, and gently but continuously steering both team members and their own managers in the new desired direction. So I just love this phrase, gentle pressure, relentlessly applied. You know, when I was a kid, a long, long, long time ago, my father once told me, look, if you're ever in a crowd and there's a bunch of people trying to get through the same door, just keep your feet moving and you'll get there. I've tried it. It works. My dad was right about something. It was a real eye opener. But that actually works. You just keep your feet moving and you will get there. And process improvement is the same kind of thing. You just kind of keep gently pushing in the same direction that you're trying to go and you will get there. So here's an example of another lesson, which is that unless you take the time to learn and improve, you should not expect your next project to go any better than the last one. You have no foundation for that expectation. So process improvements and other changes do not happen by themselves or for no reason. Something has to trigger them, providing the information and the impetus to try something different to get better results. That means the team has to take some time to assess its previous performance and results so it can then focus some effort on the right improvement targets. And the process of reflecting on an experience to learn how to handle the next one better is called a retrospective. I imagine many of you have participated in retrospectives because that's a common sort of thing on all projects, including Agile projects these days. And as it happens, there's an important book called, very simply, Project Retrospectives, written by a man named Norman Kerth, K-E-R-T-H. Turns out Norm is my closest friend. He lives here in Portland. And I think that's a really great book to read if you're interested in this process. So all software project teams should perform retrospectives at the end of a development cycle, such as a release or an iteration, at the project's conclusion, and when some surprising or disruptive event occurs. Now, a retrospective is not a free-form gripe session. It's a structured sequence of activities. You have to do some planning, you kick off the event, you gather some information, you prioritize and analyze issues, and then very importantly, you decide, what are we going to do with the information we collected? So there's some inputs to a retrospective. The team members provide not just their experiences, but their emotions. I think that's an important part of a retrospective, to think about how people felt about what was going on, because we're working together and that has issues. You might have some project records that you collected of events that took place that were significant to the project, maybe metrics that were collected, such as actual versus targeted schedule results, and whatever's important to you to measure about how you're doing. And then there are some outputs. One output is a set of lessons learned, which are insights we want to remember for future work, whether it's an iteration or a project or someplace else in the organization. You might think about things that happened that surprised you, perhaps unpleasantly, and see if we can add those to a list of potential risks for future teams to consider. And then you might come up with suggested changes in how we do things the next time, which leads to an improvement action plan. But the most important output from a retrospective is the team's commitment to making changes that will improve both their work life and their effectiveness. Just simply holding a retrospective on its own, that doesn't change anything about how things go the next time. It has to feed into ongoing SPI activities. It's important to remember also, a retrospective is more of an interpersonal interaction than a technical activity. And as such, you have to conduct those with consideration and respect for all the participants. So we've taken a whirlwind tour here through a cross-section of the first 59 lessons that I've learned in my career. And I want to just say a few words here about the final lesson in the book, what to do next, which is that you can't change everything at once. No matter how many points of pain, improvement ideas, or desirable destinations you identify, people and organizations can only absorb change at a limited rate. I once worked with a highly motivated 20-person project team, and they tackled 7 major improvement initiatives at once. The priorities weren't clear and the resources were spread thin, and of course, everybody still had work to do on their project. So despite their enthusiasm, this team accomplished little on their change journey. An important key word in any change initiative is focus. You need to identify a small number of both feasible and high impact areas to address initially, and then see them through to completion where you start getting the benefits of the work you put into it. So effective change, whether it's at the individual level or the team or the organizational level, requires that you honestly assess your current performance, you identify problem areas, you select changes that you think would add values, and you prioritize them. And one way I did this is when I was a developer, every time I started working on a new project, I'd pick out 2 areas I wanted to get better at. Might be things like estimation or modeling or algorithm design, unit testing, data modeling, or anything else. Then I would learn about those topics. I'd spend some of my time learning, maybe take a course or read a book, and I'd look for opportunities to apply them on my current project, recognizing that the first times you try new things, you're going to face learning curves, and then they're going to slow you down a little bit. But you just have to bite the bullet on that and push through to learn how to make them work for you. So process improvement is a cycle, and here's a change cycle I've found to be effective. You start with some kind of an assessment. You know, just take a look at yourself, and that can be formal or informal. Sometimes it's better to have somebody from the outside take a look because, you know, they're not going to have the biases and blinders on that you might from inside. But we can all take a look at our own work and say, what could we do differently? What do we want to make sure we do again? And then you plan some changes that you might want to make. That part's easy. The hard part is actually doing something different. You know, putting those plans into action and then giving them enough time to try to kick in so that you can go back and see, are we getting the benefits that we were hoping for by making these changes in how we work? And then you go back and continue the cycle with another assessment of where things are today, because there's always something you can do better the next time. So I hope you've gotten some ideas from this presentation about practices that would be valuable for your personal performance and your project teams. I've got these 60 lessons and a lot of technical practices that apply to a wide range of software project activities. And like most practitioners, I learned many of these lessons the hard way. I made mistakes, or I didn't get the results I wanted. And then I thought about what I would do differently the next time. As a consultant, sometimes I was fortunate because I could see mistakes that other people had made. And that way I could see what they did that also succeeded, as well as did not work well. And then I could learn some of those lessons quicker and with less pain than suffering through them all myself. I wrote this book to collect many of the important things I've learned since I started programming decades ago, with the hope that they'll save you some time, accelerate your path through some of the learning curves that you face as a software development professional. And I hope you'll also share your own lessons learned about software development with your colleagues and be receptive to their experiences so that we can all learn how to build better software. So I do have a little something here for you. There is a magic code, which is my name, and that's W-I-E, I before E except after C, G-E-R-S. And if you can get, I think 35% off software development pearls from the publisher at their website, informit.com. And if you search for that book and enter that code Wiegers during checkout, you should get a nice little break on the price. So that's what I have for you here tonight. I'll be happy to stick around and we can chat.